Welcome back, everyone, to the Insomnia True Server Championship. We're onwards to the second match of the day. We had the first one. Super JJ took it over Kalento. Our next contestants are Ness and Legendaren, who are local players. I mean, Ness is a local player, and Legendaren as well. So
Ness has qualified and got this far. Last Ice Series, he got into second place. This is where he finished. So a bit of an ongoing occurrence of him performing well at this event, which is good for him. Yeah. UK player, of course. So he's doing really well. He's performed well. I think he's favored his Priest mostly throughout the tournament. He's really liking that deck with the additions. I think he's been playing some of the new cards as well. So that's always going to be fun to see. And Legendaren plays for London Conspiracy. I think his sort of breakout performance, at least this year, was in Gfinity, where he got first place. So it's going to be a good match overall. It's going to be a tough one. I think we said earlier it was like 50-50.
Yeah, it's hard to call this
right.
One, right?
Since we don't have too much, we don't know the players too much, and that's going to be nice maybe to get a bit more information about how they play. We've seen Ness play quite a bit yesterday. You know, the Priest is one of the decks that I think went out pretty quick, but the addition of the Curator to the entire class really, you know, helps it round up the card draw without relying on, you know, North Shire Circle, so that gives him a little bit of an edge there. I kind of like it, honestly.
Yeah, and on the flip side there, I think Legendaren, who played yesterday on stream, he actually 3-0'd with his Rogue as well. So the Rogue, you know, whether he's going to start with that lineup, because I think Ness's lineup overall is pretty weak versus Rogue. I think he's playing Priest, Druid, and Paladin, which I believe is mid-range Paladin. I think he's gonna have a rough go of it this time.
Especially the Priest and the Paladin, right? The Rogue.
Yeah.
The Druid. I'm not sure if he's playing with the Harrison Jones, but the Druid has always a chance to win against any kind of deck because of the fact that he can just innervate anything that can be just abusing the fact that it's earlier in the game. So I think the Druid is his best deck in this lineup and his best option to just win the game, and maybe he should start with that and just...
It's tough in Last Hero Standing, right? Because in Conquest, you're like, yeah, eventually I'm going to have to win with everything, so it doesn't really matter when I face them. But when it comes to Last Hero Standing, that pick order is very important.
I think a lot of this match is going to rely on who picks what first.
Right.
Because on one side, Ness could be like, well, Druid's my best bet versus Rogue, 100%. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But so it's like, I want to pick Druid into Rogue, no matter what. So then it's like, do I wait for him to play Rogue, pick something else to start off with, or is Legendaren going to pick Rogue first and just try and 3-0 him?
It's kind of fine to pick Druid as an opener anyway, right? Because of Last Hero Standing, if you win with it, it's fine. You can keep going.
Yeah, but if he loses with it, he can't snipe the Rogue.
Sure.
That's the problem. Like, he needs to hold on to it to try and snipe.
You can sweep with it, right, technically?
I think going for the sweep with Druid might probably be the best option.
Yeah.
There's like the mind games that your opponent might think that you will go with the Druid, so he won't start with the Rogue, but then he'll think that, well, your opponent will predict that, so we'll actually not open with Druid, so I should open with Rogue. And then it actually Druid. So it's like... Yeah.
You can take the mind games too far, that's the
and
problem
one
as well.
One step too far and suddenly you're back to where you were initially.
Yeah.
That being said, we'll watch a quick video with the players before we move on to seeing them play their match, so enjoy that.
My name is Anton Danielsson. I go by the name of Legendaren. I play for London Conspiracy and I'm from Sweden. I think I played good overall. I've been here for 2 days now and I've only lost one game. Now that I'm in the top 16, I feel good about it, and that was my goal. The last game was the most challenging since I had to win it, otherwise I would go into a tiebreaker. My approach for tomorrow is the same as the last few games. I've had a lot of success with my lineup, so I think it's pretty good. I hope to get a good night's sleep and then just come back and win it.
This is my second time at Insomnia. The first one I went to, I came second. So, I thought, well, I might come back and try again if I can come second. Of course, this tournament's a lot bigger and there's invited players, but I thought, yeah, I'll try again. Sure, maybe I'll make it. And going for first place this time, but second place will still be pretty good. I got quite lucky in a few games, but that's Hearthstone, I guess. There were a few times in some matches where I thought I was definitely going to lose, and I just had some cards or top decks which saved me completely. I've got a few decks which I think the viewers might enjoy. If they saw me on stream yesterday, they'll know that one of my decks is quite creative, and it's not very commonly played.
So he was probably referring to his Priest deck. He was saying, you know, I have one of my decks that's pretty creative and not commonly played. I'm assuming that's Priest.
I think so.
Yeah, it's got to be, right?
So. I really hope he plays Rafam. in his deck.
Cursor, I mean Arc Thief for Farm, that is the, like, it's a threat that looks like it's joining kind of Ysera and Nefarian on the bench of big 9 drops that give you like a crazy potential finisher or card advantage. But in Priest, I mean, you want to play it, but it's also difficult sometimes to find something to combine it with, right? Like, if Rafan gets dealt
combined with most of the time, you'll just take the fill the board with the free freeze, yeah, right? Sure. Because then you play just Patron Warrior.
Well, that's the power of the card, isn't it? You just you pick whatever you need at that situation. If you have the board, then you take the +10/+10 and just burst next turn. Right. But if you don't, then you can just make the board instead of 3/3. So.
Or you just take Avenging Wrath.
Yeah.
A better
or
one.
Or 10 mana. Like, you get 2 more missiles. Is that no? It's 4 more. That is for 4 more mana, basically.
Yeah.
So you're paying.
It's
like,
not the best deal.
Right. It's a pretty bad deal. But sometimes, if there's nothing on board and you just need the 10, you don't have a minion. You can't wait for the board to be flooded.
Right.
Pyroblast. it kind of works in some cases. It's a nice touch. So I mean, I don't exactly know all the lineup from Legendary. The exact deck.
There's a hunter, right?
I think so. I just saw a lot of rogue games. Here we go. So we have rogue druid warlock. He was against hunter yesterday.
Visual
plays the hunter. Yeah.
Runs the deck. That's right. So, rogue druid warlock for legendary and Ness with the druid paladin priest. So there are quite a few differences here.
Yeah, the crazy deck Ness might have been talking about could have been dragon druid. We won't know.
Dragon druid.
Could find out.
Come on. I can't believe this is true, especially if you're
Brand Dornass's Aspirant, Blackwing Corruptor.
Well,
Brand Dornass's could be fun at some stage, but turn 5 ramp, right?
It's bad when the Maligos Hunter player of the three of us is not convinced by a deck.
I know, I know, man.
I mean, usually Brand Bronzebeard is not that great when your deck has like the
choose ones.
The choose ones.
Choose ones, but they're not battle cries.
Which is why you replace them with battle cries.
So you play
Keeper of the Grove? No, I want double silence and owl.
Double Spellbreaker.
Well, it has almost the same stats.
Right.
Yeah, reverse.
Yeah. Dies to 3/2s though. So looks like we're gonna be seeing the Paladin from Ness versus the Warlock from Legendary, and the lineups are reversed here, I believe, on the side.
Yeah, that's Legendary is playing Rogue, right? So we'll probably see that switch in a few seconds.
Right.
But Legendary is playing Reno Warlock, right? That looks like so.
Is it
the Maligos?
I think it's Maligos actually.
Okay.
I think it is. Don't. If 100%
that's true,
on that one, but
if that's true, the Maligos version is way better against Paladins because of the double Hellfire
and Shadow Flame.
And that was a Hellfire. It's one of the MVP cards here in this matchup. So if you don't have it in your hand, you shall tap as soon as possible to get it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you can make a comeback.
And the double Drake pretty much signifies it's not Malilock. Not Malilock. I mean, not Reno Lock.
Oh, sure,
it's
not Reno Lock, but it is, in fact, Malilock.
The two dragons signify it's not a dragon deck. Yeah, that was silly.
And then this big blue dude, you know, for 9 mana there.
Oh,
it,
yeah,
it
that's
looks
a,
like someone
it looks like
I played
the deck has Malagos in it.
Yeah.
Interesting enough, it's not Malagos on the picture itself.
Yeah,
it's Caligos, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like the Kodo Cliffhoof distinction on the stampeding Cliffhoof.
I can't really remember in World of Warcraft history if Malagos was even a card. We'll have to check that.
I do not remember it being one. I know there was a lot of blue Dragonflight cards, but no Malagos himself, if I recall.
Oh, I'm the odd one out, never playing that game. Feels bad.
And a Keeper Overlord will bring some value in the beginning of the game. Look at that.
Yeah.
Will we see the Implosion so early on, or do you just go for Twilight Drake?
Fine. But still big, even though the hand's not like super full, still a big body and can deal with both of these minions if it has to.
Yep, there's a Twilight Drake being played on board. It's a 4/7 minion, there's nothing to scoff on, and especially that it takes down both minions and it's not being traded by.
Oh god, that Treasure
Champion
is the card that Ness was looking for. Blessing of Kings was probably good enough if he runs that card at all. But the 2-server champion means that he can get recurring value from his weapon in the future turns, which helps him get tempo even further. So a very solid outcome for him here.
I really like how he went for the gank boss instead of killing the One-Eye Drake as soon as possible. Because you will kill it next turn anyway, and you didn't lose any of your board at all in this situation.
Yeah, and it's like you just have to imagine that Legend Iron's going to make a trade for you with the Twilight Drake as well, so you may as well get the value and, like you said, save the board. Implosion is going to come down and hit for three, which is pretty reasonable, actually. Consecrate is available.
But would you use it?
Eh.
I think Shredder's kind of alright, right?
By the way, the was thinking about the Justicar. Would there be a place to play, actually a time slot to play it against the Malagos Warlock? And I find it harder to believe that that would be a good point.
Yeah, Blackwing Corruptor just punishes you too much, right?
Yeah, like, Hellfire, Dark Bombs, right. Blackwing Corruptor, there are so many options.
Yeah. Speaking of which.
Tap into Twilight Drake seems like a very decent option.
Yeah, you definitely want the Corruptor to actually do something a little bit more than just hitting phase for three.
It's good with Bran, late game, but otherwise useless.
Yeah, and the thing is, because he has Malagos in hand, like, he doesn't have to worry about keeping hold of a dragon to proc the Corruptor. That, you know, when Malagos comes down, you imagine the game's probably going to be over. So he has the dragon synergy, like, throughout the deck now.
Well, Justicar looks like it's going to find a slot to be played. And the thing is, right now, if the Corruptor's played, right now Ness doesn't have any quality to go with that Consecration, right?
And the problem is, even though he plans to do the Quartermaster to play next turn just with two minions from the Hero Power, he is that so much losing tempo and damage because of that Blackened Corruptor. Because that is 9 damage next turn.
That is what we could say is probably a very hopeful and optimistic Justicar is what this was.
Yeah.
Because it didn't likely do anything considering you know there's Quartermasters in that deck.
I would rather see the Sylvanas being just played on board than the Justicar.
Probably, yeah. Just because it forces the opponent to start weakening his own dragon.
Yes, exactly.
And maybe then if he calls Sylvanas, then it's fine because you just get the Drake. And if he doesn't trade, then you're just buying time. And then Justicar does even more work.
Yeah, and the benefit Legend Iron has in this matchup as a whole is he can do exactly what he wants to do as a Malilock and just freely tap because there's no burst coming from mid-range Paladin. Like, he's on 16, and he can still probably make another 2-3 taps before he feels like there's any real danger, whilst keeping the board clear, of course.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How long until we start seeing combo decks from Pally?
A long, long time. Because, you know, the Murloc deck, that'll work.
I'm talking about Blessing of Might, Faceless.
No.
Never.
Arcane Golem, double Blessing, Faceless. Just 20.
So there's already Soulfire in the hand of Legend Iron, and he has a Dark Moon too. What he needs is an Emperor to play it as soon as possible, otherwise he has an access to 9 damage burst on turn 10, which is 2 turns away, which is not bad because you can deal 9 damage right now. Or you can go for the Implosion to increase the chances of stealing a 1-1 instead of the 4-8, but then you have
kind
to trade
like with Heal
Bot.
Yeah,
like
just like
Heal Bot,
tap Heal
Zombie
Bot
Chow. Like tap. Okay. You tap, you heal bot, your zombie chow, he steals probably two worthless minions. Right?
Ooh, well that kind of changes the plan.
Do you dark bomb now?
Tap and dark bomb seems like the best option in my opinion.
I think you definitely want to tap because you want Thorison, but the problem is dark bomb now removes one of his burst cards. He does have Soulfire. He's just going to trade, okay.
Whatever happens, he can kill what comes out. Well, that's a dark bomb target if he ever wants one, but he's going to keep it for face.
I'm really surprised that he played the endgame boss after his opponent got the 4-3 minion.
Would you not value the tap higher?
I would value the tap into dark bomb the Sylvanas more than anything else.
I think it comes down to certain like discomfort in tournament play sometimes, where you're starting to fear that the Sylvanas just turns the game around out of nowhere. But we pretty much know that this just can't happen, right? Like, it's just that it's a card that you're used to just playing around way too much.
Yeah. I just think, like, if you kind of, with that hand, want to draw into Emperor as quickly as possible. Because if you draw into Emperor, you just win, right?
Yeah, you just like, throw spells to face and win.
Yeah. So the tap was really valuable every single turn. And I didn't even mind tap Healbot the previous turn and just go face and let the Sylvanas do what it wants to do.
Yeah, like, don't even play the Chao. Like, you could feed them a Chao with Sylvanas, but it doesn't even matter at that stage. You could
also, if you play Chao and it doesn't steal it, you can kill Chao to then heal past your burst.
Right.
Whereas now you're forcing either a Healbot or a Lay on Hands. So this looks like it's just going to be hit Hellfire Peddler.
He's got 15 damage right now, right? So 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, he's 1 mana off of killing his opponent if he picks up another Soulfire or a PO from the Dark Peddler. But either way, I think the Hellfire will be coming down. Whether it's Hellfire Heal Block, right?
8 damage to the face. Yeah. Then you can just play Peddler.
Healbot is like.
It's also, that if you do Hellfire now and then play, say, even just Peddler Healbot next turn, he can Malygos Soulfire. And then with the minions on board, should
you
be enough
finish
to
him
push
off,
through.
Yeah.
Right. Well, this is just Soulfire's lethal with Malygos, right?
Yeah.
And it's 9
it
damage,
is,
right?
It is, yeah. But Ness will have to play the Healbot in this situation. Because
yeah, I don't think there's a world in which you don't drop Healbot here.
Yeah, he has to recognize the threat. And I think what's interesting to now is that he knows on turn 10 he can go Hero Power, Muster, Quartermaster.
Yeah.
So he's thinking, well, if I can just stay alive one turn and get the tempo, then I might be able to win by just establishing a crazy board if we don't see another Hellfire. And I like the choice he made here of playing the Murloc Knight.
Ooh, how much damage is that? 4, 6, 8, 11 damage.
Wow.
If you get...
So far.
You got a Dark Petal, right?
PO, then you're 2 of lethal.
But you can still play it somewhat slowly, unless there's a Lay on Hands out of nowhere. I think tapping and seeing what you get from it is the first step, no matter what.
I would play the Dark Petal first.
Oh, Guardian.
That's interesting, because if you find Burst, you would change maybe your game plan around that immediately.
If you know what you're getting from the Dark Peddler, it might affect your game plan, and you want to play the Peddler anyway.
Well,
not the biggest Burst cards we've ever seen.
Well, yeah. I mean, Young Dragon Hawk with Abusive looks ridiculous. But it is a card I would consider when I don't see 1-1s on the board. You know, you play Young Dragon Hawk here with Twilight Guardian, Zombie Chow, and suddenly you have like 3 minutes on board, and the Young Dragon Hawk represents 4 free damage.
I don't think you would like to play the Zombie Chow in this situation.
Sure, you don't have to, of course.
That's a problem. I'm kind of surprised that he didn't take, actually, the Young Dragon Hawk, because the Voidwalker doesn't do anything.
Right, the Twilight Guardian, it's double dipping. Like, it's kind of like, it's superfluous, right? When you already have the 3-6 with Dawn.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's... an interesting play. Now, we see the Quartermaster play looking very appealing for Ness, just because he wants to get that big threat like on the board right now. And you see the Healbot just killing the Voidwalker, as we talked about. Like, it's not protected.
It was actually just lost 2 damage. One damage. It's actually 2, because he didn't attack with the Voidwalker. Yeah. So it's actually 2 damage. So next turn you have 3, 5, 7, 9, and 13, 16.
Did he play
one
Threader
of lethal
instead of Quartermaster?
Yes.
And now you have 3, 5, 7, and 9. Right?
One off, right?
Yeah.
Another day, another one off. But here, what's cool is because he doesn't have Hellfire, and I say what's cool, not from his perspective, because he doesn't have Hellfire, there's a chance that Ness just goes crazy with a Quartermaster.
I just want to go back, like, that Voidwalker
actually
mattered.
Right.
He would have won this.
He would have won right now, yeah. I know.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
It was
a
big deal.
That's kind of crazy.
I was surprised.
And now he's tapping into...
Oh,
and that's a very dangerous situation.
You gotta be killing those cards. You know, the problem he's running into now is, if I kill anything...
What's crazy here,
though? Actually, he's got lethal, right? Yeah, that's it, GG.
Is it?
I think it is. Yeah, 5 plus. Yeah, that.
He needs to play the second Twilight Guardian, but then two minions are just crashing into that, two into that, and it's 4-7.
No, he has lethal right now. You Corruptor of the Face, and you Dark Bomb Soulfire. What?
Oh, you're talking about this. Sorry.
Oh.
Well, yeah, he just top decked the lethal.
Oh, really? Hang on. We need to go back. Oh, yeah, because the Abusive
has
2
four,
more as well.
Right.
Abusive Dark Peddler is 4.
He has 4, 5, 6, 7, plus
7.
Another 7. He has 14.
Oh, God.
He just
drifted out. It's like already counting damage from Paladin.
No. And now look at that. What if the Quartermaster wins the game?
The thing you hear as well is Ness pretty much told Legendar and he didn't have Quartermaster. Because he's seen the Hellfires, he played Shredder instead of Quartermastering his board full of 1-1s. So it just gives Legendar and like, oh, well, surely he would have played Quartermaster,
but
right?
Now you have to ask yourself, do I Tyrion or do I Quartermaster? You have to clear the board, so you have to play
Quartermaster.
Exactly. You can't afford not to. Plus, you get to kill a Zombie Chow.
Yeah, you heal,
which heals you. That's insane.
Oh.
That's insane.
Also, interesting situation that he wasn't able to Hero Power.
No.
Because it would fill up the board, and then he wouldn't be able to kill the Zombie Chow.
You gotta kill that Chow, mate. Alright, there it is. I would not play the Zombie Chow. Help yourself and avoid Hellfire being worse for you than it is now.
Would you play the BGH? Because like,
what's no targets, right?
Yeah, yeah. What you gonna BGH?
But you played the Chow instead. Okay. Whoa. So.
But how much damage is then on board?
If you play Thorsten, you have to Dark Bomb the Zombie Chow to guarantee survival, right? 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So you would die to another Quartermaster if you don't kill the Chow.
Don't you have to go for it because you win next turn?
Yeah, exactly. But you don't win. If you play Thorsten and you Dark Bomb the 2-3, you don't win next turn.
Yeah, do you not just have to play Thorsten's pass? Thorsten BGH?
Man.
But then you're dead on board.
You're dead. You're going to die. Well, not on the board necessarily.
Two off.
But there's a lot of things that could kill you. Another Quartermaster, a True Silver, a Kings. Maybe it's worth the risk.
Yeah, well, you're not expecting Kings in mid-range, right?
Yeah, I mean, it depends what Legendary is putting his opponent on, but yeah, I think you tend not to see that card.
Even
in
one Quartermaster, your opponent only has two cards.
Right.
Oh, I don't know.
As long as he doesn't
tap. It's just like, other than Lay on Hands, because again, he probably, you've got to presume Ness isn't playing double Healbot. Unless top deck Lay on Hands, then you've just got to assume that this gives you lethal next turn, so.
Yeah, and looks like he's going to get the lethal based on what Ness has here. Vitality Totem could change things up. But that's about
anything else? I don't think there's any other drop that will save him, right?
No, Mana Wraith makes the Malagos cost 9, but it doesn't really help you. A two cost card that heals you Lightwell, but it's too late.
Yeah.
Nope,
that's not it.
Can't think of one. So it will be the end for Ness. Legendary will feel a little bit relieved, but he did have lethal earlier if he wanted to pick it up. Just didn't spot it. I think he was already looking at the Malagos.
It's probably better if he continues this series without realizing he missed lethal, because that will throw you off your game a little
bit. No, I think he should realize that, because then he knows he should count more.
Yeah, I suppose it could go both ways, right?
Happy Feast of Wintervale, champion. Yeah, that's it. So game number one goes to Legendaren with the Malagos Warlock, which means he's going to get to replay it. But there is a Priest, you know, to go up against, and there's also a Druid. How do you feel about Malagos Warlock against Priest?
I think it favors the Malagos Warlock so much, it's not even funny. Like,
it's not even funny.
Yeah, it's like very similar to Handlock, right? Okay. Very similar to Handlock, but the fact is that you have so much threats in your deck, you just push them on the board. And then on the downside of playing Malagos Warlock against the Priest is the fact that your endgame bosses can be taken by Cabal Shadow Priest, and that's it.
Yeah. Like, you'd have to run into very specific Light Bomb and Tomb heavy decks to start being, you know, pushed off. And even then, sometimes that's a bit late. You know, Twilight Drake, Azure Drake comes out, and then you're starting to curve already in your late game. And the Priest really can't do much, because unlike Giants, you can't Shadow Ward Death them for the most part.
Yep, so Ness is going to lock in the Druid. Double Aspirant into Savage Roar.
Yeah. Okay. This is the kind of hand that either is going to be terrible or amazing, depending on his follow-up.
And Legend Iron's got double Twilight Drake. Twilight Guardian, should I say.
That's a good opening
hand,
I'll
that's say. Pretty nice. On the coin as well. Do you want to coin out the Gang Boss?
I don't think you want to coin out anything here.
Yeah, you just wait. Oh, goodness gracious.
Do you not want to coin out the Guardian?
Double Aspirant?
This is Aspirants. Lothar doesn't care about Druid Ramp. He wants to tap.
I mean, if you can innervate Emperor on turn 4, like, if your Aspirant lives here, you innervate the Emperor, maybe that's just straight up better. Actually, it is, obviously, in many cases, straight up better than getting the Aspirant out.
Yeah, because you're effectively gaining mana anyway by the reduction in the hand.
It's ramping. Every play you make here ramps you up.
It's going to go for the Gang Boss. It's because, I guess because he has Mortal Coils, right?
Yeah, setting up the coil to kill the Aspirant.
Play that, but the fact is that if there's a Pile to Shredder, it's still awkward for you.
Yep.
And the Emperor will just be even more awkward.
He could pick up an Abusive off the top. That would change the game. Pick up Abusive off the top, sacrifice the Imgang boss, and coil the Emperor. Because then you can start curving your Twilight Guardians into the Druid.
Having a 2-mana Savage already so fast in hand changes the perspective of the matchup, because you know that you can combo to an 8, so it can be even more aggressive. But what he needs to do is to draw
Druid of the Claw, pass the shot the next turn, or just coin, Wrath into a Flaw
Toll. Cycle, exactly, yeah.
Yeah, I think we're going to see Wrath. Although you normally like to keep Wrath for the three attack, in this situation, you do definitely need to cycle a bit more and draw into the bigger cards.
And Legendary in here, not really picking up anything he's looking for, which is a little unfortunate for him. We see Ness, the reduction he's getting, they're not that impactful in that they're not going to let him play, really good minions, but as long as the Emperor is not dealt with, he's doing whatever he wants with this game.
You use the 2-mana Wrath here, right?
Most likely.
Because unless the 1-mana Wrath becomes 0-mana, and 0-mana spells are pretty good.
Well, you can also go for Dionysus Aspirant, Wrath, and Hero Power.
I think that's what that's what I would do in this spot, but...
I just think you're so far ahead with Thorason on board.
If you can just keep it.
You have a great turn 5.
Yeah.
You have an Azure Drake and Rav at the same time.
And because of the discount, it doesn't matter whether or not you're ramping. Like, you're already guaranteed that you can play it.
Yeah.
No, I'm really, really surprised that he is killing.
He's going to cycle this, is what it means. That means he's cycling the Wrath for an extra card, which, looking at the way that he values the Emperor's discount, I think that's in line with his plays. If he doesn't, however...
Yeah, he wants the Drake Wrath next turn, doesn't he?
Well, that's why you'd keep the...
I don't know
how to play, but that was a little...
I didn't like the trade. That's sacrificing 5 damage to not important minion at all, because the Abusive Surgeon doesn't change anything in this situation. Yeah. If your opponent has a Dark Bomb or Hellfire, you're losing the board and 5 damage along the line.
And the thing is as well, if there's a way to beat Maligos, it's to be hyper-aggressive and just win before they can draw through all their AoEs and through their bigger minions and then maybe eventually Maligos into the combo. You just go hyper-aggressive, and like you said, you've got a 1-mana Savage Roll.
And I love this about Legendary's hand right now, is that he can play Twilight Guardian, followed by the Corruptor, because he's got the other dragon. And by the time, he's guaranteed to be playing the second Twilight Guardian, there's a chance he picks up another dragon to enable that one. So he's going to be able to set up taunts quite effectively over a few turns.
Two? Ooh, okay.
He took the 33% chance of getting completely thrown out of the game. But it paid off.
Yeah.
In this case, it was not a disaster it could have been.
Yep, now he has a pretty nice Corruptor and trade one of the 1/1s into the. He has your Drake to clear that up and just leave the Aspirant on board.
I feel like just pushing face was fine with every. The Emperor and the Aspirant should have been dealing damage to that Warlock's face. He would be down to 19 right now.
Yep.
He attacks face here. Yep.
There's a lot of damage lost in this matchup already, and judging by the hand of the druids, it looks promising.
And even that trade there, you've just killed the 1-1, you've left a 1-1 on board. What are you playing around? That extra one.
It's dead to Dark Bomb, it's dead to Black and Corruptor.
I can tell you right now what it is. It's basically the overly safe plays you make
when you're nervous.
Nervous. It's basically. What happens very often when you see new players come on to the tournament scene.
Just try not to lose, right?
Mindset. That's the thing. I need to go through, and I need not to lose. And sometimes making the play to win means that you have to commit to lines of play that you're just not comfortable with.
Yeah.
So there are a few ways of thinking this turn. Ancient of Blow is the most common and obvious play, but the fact is that the opponent will just trade with the Black King Corruptor makes the Ancient of Blow awful. So I wouldn't just mind Palette Shredder, Wrath for free, Hero Power.
I love
trade,
that play.
And just go phase with the Dionysus Aspirant. You still have a decent minion on the board.
And you can just follow up with the Ancient of Law to draw later.
Yeah, exactly. So
it's not like he was want of any other options. He did have a couple there.
This is just it seems like a mana efficient play, and you get more cards deep into your deck, but the combo was not helping at all because you weren't aggressive. I would have maybe seen this play if Ness was very aggressive in the early game with the Emperor and with the Dionysus Aspirant, but now...
He would have had more of a board, right?
Yes,
so then it's not just 1-for-1. And we see now the Legend Iron's actually cleared off without using the Corruptor, And suddenly, this is one of the other strengths of Malygos Lock, where not just about Malygos and burst them down with spells. A lot of the minions are big and like do quite a lot of damage every turn. So if they can just build up and just play sort of more beatdown variant,
yeah,
which would be more difficult for Legendarian if he was under more pressure in the health-wise.
Just, but it seems to be the problem in this game is the fact that Ness doesn't really can decide who is the beatdown.
Yeah.
He hasn't determined yet if he's got that role, and he's given it to his opponent now, right?
Exactly.
He's handed it over.
And now he's playing very defensively, which I can understand in this position. But at the same time, it's still not the way you should be playing this matchup in general, because your opponent will always have the upper hand of having the retroactive cards like Black Incorruptus and Dark Bombs just to clear the way. And here, the Twilight Guardian is even better than those.
The problem is as well, Druid is known to not be able to deal with big boards. Like, yeah. That's actually part of the class. And the longer the game goes on, it just favors the Malygos Lock even more because the deck's built around late game.
Yeah,
and then more answers,
whereas like
Druid's
that,
much
though.
More mid-range.
And that's one of the things that I think, you know, when you hear a lot of talk about pro Hearthstone players, and I think very often it doesn't come down to the things necessarily that you see when you watch them play, because they make the moves sort of naturally, and you see them go face, but they don't have the perfect information. And usually, you know, people ask themselves, you know, what would I do in that spot if I were them? But the thing you have to do is actually hide the opponent's hand,
reset
the game, and then figure out what your move would be. And if you can figure out what your move would be all the way through and it matches, you know, somebody who
you're in a
just
good
does
position,
super well, then you're good. But very often, because we're casting this from, like, perfect information positions, and viewers are watching that as well, it feels like the decisions are, you know, self-evident.
Yeah, yeah.
And now you
seem really
see
obvious,
your Ness,
but it's going to be obvious, right?
Right.
To us.
But what we can see Ness here falling to the trap of not making the quote-unquote obvious plays that we've learned to spot as viewers, because he's always afraid. You know, always on the back foot. He's like, the worst case scenario is X and Y, and I'm going to play around the worst case scenario, not the average, the worst.
And what you really want to do in most games, there are certain decks that don't quite play like this, but you want to be the person who threatens your opponent. You want your opponent to deal with you, not for you to consistently just say, okay, well, I'm going to tech in all these answers to things my opponents play. Instead, no, you want to be the one providing the issues and make your opponent deal with them.
Yeah.
And that's something we've seen, obviously, the flip side here, where Ness is just super reacting to everything and not actually... I mean, the Warlock's still on 23. Like, it's crazy. Like, the amount of chances that Ness had to just push, the Warlock would have had to have dealt with them, especially seeing Emperor so early. For all Legendarian knew, Emperor was hitting combo twice, right? So he has to be wary of that, and he has to play around that to a certain extent.
Well, we're going to hope to see maybe the Priest do a bit better, because against the, you know, we know it's a very lopsided matchup in the favor of the Warlock, as we talked about this. If Ness can't pick this win, which looks like it's going to be very difficult with the amount of damage on board right now and the fact that there's a Blackwing Corruptor. In order to win this game, how does Ness approach this? Like, is there even a way for him to do so? Do you have to use Druid of the Claw, Savage Roar, Druid of the Claw, Lotheb, get stuff on board, top deck combo, and then push for one, you know, one fell swoop of lethal?
It's going to be really rough. Because of the board state now, there's still so many pick minions on Legendarian's side that even this play, the Lotheb does lock out obviously all the crazy spell stuff that can happen from the Warlock, but he just has enough minions to just push through anyway. It just doesn't matter.
The Lotheb is really not that important in this situation, because the fact is that he can deal with minions, and like Druid of the Claw would have been just a minion that will deal damage this turn.
Yeah.
And he needs that right away, because usually you of course want to play the minion that is slower, but you are in a losing position.
He's trying to get the damage in at some point, and it's going to be based on the top deck of probably Force of Nature at some soon to be state. But now the board is basically getting answered card for card.
Yeah, and this is the issue. Like when you play the defensive play, but the defensive play gets cleared up by the board that's already there, it's like you're still behind after that point.
Well, that's kind of the strength of Malygos Warlock, and I think Warlock decks in general, right? The class has access to the card draw that enables them to get, you know, those tools consistently, so they can keep putting on the pressure, which is something that you can't necessarily do as any other class. So that hero power on its own means that the general approach you have to take against Warlocks is always similar. When we're talking about mid-range Demon Lock, Malagos Warlock, Handlock, you always kind of take the same line of play with high pressure.
It's not even about aggressive minions. They're just they're just persistent.
They're just big. They're just big, fat, and they just keep coming. You're like, you can't really do much about it.
Well, that's how dragons should work, right?
Mm-hmm.
They should be big, badass minions.
And it is exactly what they are. I'm happy that we finally have viable dragon cards.
Yeah, I still remember the time when Twilight Drake was 1-1, and the Battlecry added plus one attack, plus one health. So that was actually a viable deck with Rogue and Twilight Drakes.
You could play Twilight Drakes everywhere, almost. And you'd almost, worst case scenario, very often, like on turn 4, it was like a Yeti. A bit better, but.
And this is the same position again. The Druid of the Claw in Taunt, it takes 6 damage, but it takes 6 damage from all of the minions that are on the board anyway. And that's just pushing the game a little bit
slower.
Isn't
that lethal? 5, 8, 10, 11, 13. No, it's not. 13, 17 damage, right?
He's got the extra damage here, right? Because he's pushing for 3, and he can go for Hellfire for 4, and Soulfire for 4. So he's got lethal.
Oh, wait, it is lethal.
Well, he has to start with Hellfire for 4.
Yeah. But Hellfire kills the Azure Drake, but it's still on 4, it's lethal.
Yep. All right, so Legendary with the Malagos Warlock taking another game, and Ness is going to have to go for his Priest, which is the last deck he's got. And maybe, just maybe, it's able to upset what we expect of it. But with a Rogue lined up, a Druid lined up behind the Malagos Warlock, he's got 3 uphill battles to fight, one after the other.
Yep, and the Priest is going to be a bit tough, I think, as well, because it falls into the trap of, the Priest can heal, so you can sort of play around some burst, but Light Bomb against things like Twilight Guardians don't really do much. Entomb's going to be important, but the minions are so beefy that they can just push through a lot of damage. And what do you actually entomb in this deck? There's Malagos, which is going to be too little too late, you'd imagine, by that point.
You could entomb, honestly, anything that you can't kill with a Shadow Word Pain or Death is usually what you're going for, right?
But even that feels really slow, right? You've removed the 1-for-1. But that's the issue with Entomb, that it's a good card in the control matchups, but it's still 6 mana. Like, that's a lot of your turn.
It didn't help
take a minion away.
It didn't help Priest deal with mid-range. Because Priest, they have this thing where they can be both good against control and aggro at the same time, but then mid-range roll all over them. There's a gap in the middle, and Light Bomb addressed that for a while. But now it's like, we have Excavated Evil. We have Holy Nova. We can start setting up, board clears over 2-3 turns and escalate our plays. But it still leaves you with that weird 4 attack and high health minion gap. Like Druid of the Claw, Twilight Drake, Twilight Guardian, even just like a 3 attack. Yes, you might play Pain, but if you don't have them, then what happens? It's like the mid-range decks are still having that edge.
Yeah. I can see a Cleric come down and coin into Powered Shield just to make it survive a little bit longer versus the Chao.
Curator.
And safe versus Mortal Coil.
Well, this looks like a very tough nut to crack for the Priest. Both Twilight Drake and Twilight Guard and Black Queen Corruptor, so like the MVPs of the deck already in hand, will make it very, very difficult for the Priest.
But he does have card draw, and usually one of the big things you have to get to compete with a Warlock at any point is to get the card draw going as a Priest. It's very tough sometimes, but when you start being able to keep up with his draw, then you're able to keep your own options open, get a better Light Bomb, because there's a Holy Nova on the back end to finish the minions off. When you have all these tools already lined up, suddenly it's not nearly as difficult.
Well, imagine Malagos.
Yeah.
Imagine Malagos right now. That will be a huge deal, because those both Mortal Coils.
Well, they will have to be used to kill this, right?
Or no, I don't think so. You just play Twilight Guardian and next turn Dark Bomb that.
Oh man.
Would you Twilight Guardian over Drake?
I would Drake, but
yeah, I would Twilight Drake.
Yeah, because then you can.
He's playing around Divine Spirit, Inner Fire. I see what it is.
I just don't know why you play Guardian.
Well, the only reason why you play Guardian here is just to have the additional 2 damage from the Zombie Chow next turn.
Next turn on the
True.
So you can Dark Bomb the Deathlord and still kill it. So you don't need to use that Mortal Coil. So you can have an insane turn with the Mortal Coil after Malagos will be
That's clearly
dropped
the play
from the Deathlord.
I like that. You know, 6 damage coils that draw a card. 1 mana, deal 6 damage to a minion, draw a card. Sounds pretty balanced.
The options, Pilot Sky Golem.
Well, the Golem is not bad.
Anubis of Sentinel, if I can say that right, and a Leper Gnome. So very different ends of the mana curve there.
Yeah, Sky Golem is obviously kind of the go-to pick, unless you want to play the Anubiseth on turn 5, which, even though it's, you know, typically considered a bad card, it's got its uses in some cases. It's just difficult to pick over something as standardly good as the Sky Golem. Well, shall we see the Malygos, Lothar?
That was the question. Do you use Dalgvom or do you use Black and Corruptor?
I think you use the Corruptor, right?
Nah, if you use the Corruptor, then you need to sacrifice Zombie Chow. If you use the Dalgvom, you use Mortal Coil instead. And you can tap still.
But the problem is, like, do you not want the second body? Because you're a turn away from Light Bomb.
The odds of, like, Malygos and Emperor coming out are actually fairly high considering the amount of minions he's got in hand. Mm-hmm. We've seen one Drake, 2 Twilight Guardians, 1 Corruptor, 2 Imp Gang bosses, like, 1 Zombie Chow. Like, the small stuff, even if you get, like, an Azure Drake, it's still kind of okay. Because you get a 2 damage coil.
Yeah. So he goes for the Corruptor. And let's see. Emperor would be pretty much insane. Yep.
Oh, the worst. It had to be the worst.
That's possibly
the worst. It's got to be the worst.
Yeah, it is the worst.
You confirm?
I'm just thinking. Yeah, it's the worst.
Well,
Holy Nova is tempting,
but
you can kill the Black and Corruptor, just leave the anti-killbot on board. You don't really care about it.
What if you don't kill the Corruptor? And you use the Nordshire to kill the heal bot afterwards. Or you attack into the Guardian with your Nordshire, and then you Nova, and then you trade the 1-2 away into the heal bot. So that lets you use Wild Pyro afterwards to finish it off, and you do draw a card in the end.
Is he going for the Deathlord?
If he's going for Deathlord, then he's escalating his clears over multiple turns. Which makes a lot of sense. It's consistent with his game plan, is what I mean.
Yeah, it's just if you play Deathlord, well, you've just seen Healbot, which is the bad one. Is he going to just straight up kill it? That's the problem. He just can kill the Deathlord next turn.
Yeah.
100%.
Yeah.
That's what I would be worried about versus Malylock.
That's a weird.
At least in the
really
previous
weird.
Turn. Yeah, the previous turn, well, he didn't have the damage on board.
Right.
So you're like, okay, he might not have it. And then you just heal, draw the game out. But and the minions don't even die.
Well,
he sets up the like Deathlord. What it does here is that it sets up a Nova that's amazing, no matter what. So what you're hoping to not see is Malygos or Emperor out of the Deathlord, and it's as likely, you know, to be the card that comes out of another one.
Ooh, well, Drake. almost
mini Malygos.
But the double Mortal Coils are just insanely good right now.
Yeah, mini Ghost, pretty good card.
And the problem is next turn, like, yeah, the Holy Nova's there, but the Drake's not going to die, and Holy Nova's your whole turn. So then the Warlock gets another turn to just drop down minions after an AoE clear.
Does he have the Light Bomb? Because the Light Bomb, in a case like this, would at least salvage a decent chunk of health.
Yeah.
It's still Twilight Guardian instead of Twilight Drake. Why is that? In this situation when you don't need the taunt at all.
And there's no Shrink Cabal possibility.
Yeah, and you will tap next turn to get out of dragons. It's very, very peculiar situation.
Do you play Sylvanas on this board, or do you have to Nova just to stall? Like, Nova's necessary, but you're still dealing with another wave of minion on 7.
I think it has to be Sylvanas.
Yeah, I agree. Because Nova saves damage this turn, but it does nothing else. And that's my issue with it, really. Like, you can't set up anything else. Whereas at least Sylvanas has to be answered in some respect.
Yeah, Holy Nova gets the town anyway, but this doesn't necessarily help him building up the board because it will get refilled.
Yeah.
And you will face the same problem. So Sylvanas has to be played after that.
That's a good thing he didn't play it. In this exact case, there was an owl, but it might
have still
not
would have
been
traded
there, right?
With some minions, though. Sure. It would have done like a part of the Holy Nova's work.
It
probably would have
one for one with the Corruptor into it.
Yeah.
Yep.
But the issue now is as well, like, in that situation, you can't presume like the Warlock won't draw into minions to play.
You can certainly hope.
Yeah, just because the Warlock's hand is big anyway, and he has live tap, so the odds of him drawing into minions to refill the board, he really just needs a Light Bomb.
That is a card
I'm really surprised by Legendarin that he played the Impagang boss.
With Cabal?
I thought that he would just not play those cards until he wins the game.
Or at least play like Peddler.
Yeah, Peddler.
And then just let that get stolen.
And
he could have tapped.
Yeah.
It's really weird.
So Ness here is going to try to extract the maximum amount of value he can out of that Akanai. He plays it, tries to incentivize trades from Legendarin, right? Which he then finishes off all the minions that are damaged with the Life Bomb. Mm-hmm. At a nearby point, but look at the amount of damage right now that Legendary is packing. He's got 9 in hand from just the minions and the spells, and he's already got another 9 on board, so he's got 18.
Yeah.
He's missing just a tiny bit to get the lethal, and if he doesn't kill the Akanai, the priest can't heal. Is that worth
sure
a lot?
Sure, if he wants to kill the Akanai.
Yeah, he's scared of Circle, right?
But what he has to do is to tap almost every single turn, and this is something he wasn't doing for a long time.
Oh.
Ooh, Angry Chicken.
Yeah, I mean, technically, I guess he could have tapped into lethal, right? If he got the other Soulfire.
What does the Angry Chicken cross the cross the road? Cross the board.
Why did it cross the board? Cabal Shadow Priest?
Yeah. I'm really surprised by those lines of play. I mean, if you leave 2 mana here, so you just want to tap anyway.
Why not tap straight away?
Yeah, why not just tap instantly?
What?
Or else he needs to squeeze Dark Bomb, man.
Dark Bomb. Oh, come on.
And now, if the Twilight Garden goes down to 1 health, and it does, Light Bomb, we'll get an amazing clear. It's not going to kill the Imp Gang boss. It's not going to kill the Drake, but it will not spawn Imps from the Gang boss.
Do you steal the Imp Gang boss instead?
I can't imagine you would. This is way too risky. Because you can steal it afterwards. The Light Bomb will not kill it. You still get
That's
it
true.
On the following turn.
I really can't understand. Do you?
Lothar is a confused star right now.
Yes, because, you know, your opponent is packing Light Bomb. He's packing Holy Novas with Valence Chosen. He's packing so much answers to what he just did on board. And you don't even spawn a 1-1 from the Imp Gang boss.
Well, let's see if Legendary can pick up the Emperor that he's going to need. Well, he does pick it up. So for Malagos,
he would have been already playing that Emperor turns before because he missed 2 taps.
He would have tapped, yeah.
And he would have the Dark Bomb in hand, and he would have used Abuse of Surgeon instead of using the Dark Bomb. So he had so much options in the previous 3 turns when he just opted to play minions into Light Bomb and trade with really unfavorable situation.
And now he just like has to tap, right? Because you need to tap into better cards than this to reduce down from Thoris.
He just plays the
Imp Gang
boss.
So he doesn't mind getting Light Bombed again, is what he's sending as a message. The thing is, right now, if Ness picks up Shadow Ward Death, I think he's in a great spot.
The problem is you just don't, you are not playing into the combo, right? And I mean, the combo is not even that important, but you need,
cards. To be fair, he has lethal, right?
Yeah, he does have it, right? He does have the Soulfire, the Abusive.
So maybe he just didn't care.
He does find the lethal anyway, but things could have been different, right? If there had been Cabal Shadow or Death, then suddenly lethal's not there anymore.
Yep.
Because you do remove the 5 damage from the Emperor off the board.
The second.
I think he might have been. Because there was like 2 overkill. I guess he would have still died by a tiny margin, but it was.
Second Light one was also a problem.
True. Absolutely.
And you're facing a control priest, so you can guess. He might be playing in Tomb.
Yeah.
Might be playing the second Light Bomb. Or just 1 Light Bomb, 1 and 2. Very
risky. Weird. But he does take a 3-0 either way. Right?
Yeah, well, he was very. The matchup was favoring the Warlock by a lot.
Yeah.
So even though his decisions were kind of shaky, he just took it, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, and again, like the lineups were just really not favored towards Ness. We saw how powerful the wallet was. Legendary didn't even need to play the Rogue, and the Rogue would have probably done a very similar job, at least to the Priest in the last match or to the Paladin earlier on. So just the lineup getting shut down pretty hard there. And that's what's difficult with, especially Last Hero Standing in this format, with the variety of decks there are now. It's like you can't build something that's going to be strong against everything.
Yeah.
You need like an ultra strong meta call to be able to build a lineup that's going to survive versus most things, never mind everything.
Yeah, maybe the team analysts have a bigger role than they ever had, right? As a result of that. So.
Yeah, I mean, this is something that people usually just ignore when it comes to meta game calls, because they think that if there's like one dominant deck, that's really bad for the metagame. It's actually healthy for the metagame to have dominant tier list, that you have two or one just really strong deck, because he is a guide to what you have to do.
Yeah, like the top decks. The top few, like if there's two to three top decks, then you know where you're supposed to be headed when you deck build, right? Like in the case of Patron, for instance, like it's a very unique case because everything was kind of warped around it, but it was like unarguably a guide. Like there's no question. It was obvious that it helped you as a deck builder, you know, pick up your decks or pick the decks you wanted to play. And now with the whole, you know, the metagame in flux with League of Explorers, it's tough. Like coming into a tournament so early after the release of The Last Wing, it's like, well, what do I really want to play? And so you see Kranich with at least Starseeker and Patron, and you see Finley pretty much everywhere. So it's just nice to see like all the changes that people have made, but no guides yet.
Yep, that's true. Yeah. But that so, was the second quarter.
We'll be taking a break, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll be taking a short break, guys, before we move on to the next match. It's going to be the third match of the day. We'll be back after the break. Stay tuned.